web application security. And especially, is there a professional responsibility of a developer? Because the, whenever a client came to you, I need that application. So maybe client do not know it, but obviously if you have a lot of data in their application, that's like a business secret. Client don't want to lose that to the competitors, to anyone else. So if your application is not secure, it is compromised, then possibly you are not doing your professional responsibility. So it's not a special thing, it's a part of developers' day-to-day responsibilities. As everyone, most of you know me, I'm Tapish Sharma. My contact details are there. All the slides at the end, you can find it on speakerdeck.com/Tapish Sharma. Let's continue with that one. What are the important factors for a web application? Is it performance? That's visible if a site is taking, say, 4 or 5 seconds to load a page. Obviously, client will start complaining. Then, maintainability. You should, if change is the only constant, obviously. You designed a site, client asked for some change, so you have to maintain it. Extend it, maintain it. That's also visible. Scalability, it's a type of performance only. Reliability, you should be completely, the system should be completely reliable. These all are visible things. But there is also security, which is not visible until unless your site is compromised. So we generally take care of these things, but the things that are not directly visible, we most of the time do them. Please come. Just start it. Sorry to have it. Yeah, just to start. Whenever you get time, just and if you are not in our WhatsApp group, just add your number as well. So I will add it. Now what? One of the common questions developer asked, why the hacker will be interested in my site? You can say, I have a very small application, I have very few users, there are no money transactions, there is nothing confidential in my site, then why someone will try to hack my site? Okay. It might not be possible that your site is having anything interested for the hacker. But for general users, it's a common, probably we have registered on 100 websites, right? It could be mail, it could be banking account, it could be say IRCTC or lot of sites. Most of us have easily are having 100 plus accounts. Do you have 100 different passwords for 100 accounts? Obviously we can't remember that. Same password, right? So if one of that site is hacked, your password for loss of account is gone, right? So even if you are having a small site, hackers are interested, at least in the passwords. If they get user ID password, they will try it on other websites. And again, if you are having something like money transactions, and even if you have money transaction, then probably they are lost. You must follow some minimal security. Even if you are not having that, it could have some confidential business critical information. So hackers are always interested in your website. Why you are safe? Because there are billions of websites. Hackers cannot go to every site. That's all, that is the only reason why we are safe. Just a small categorization of hackers. If it is going up, there are chances that if someone tries to hack your website, it will be compromised or high risk. And going right is probability of attack. So they are professional hackers. So these professional hackers are mostly security experts in their day job, but for time pass in the evening, they're hacking. They do hacks. So they do it mostly for self-satisfaction, to prove a point. At the most, illegal downloads, like download some movies, some music, but not for a monetary gain. But then there are organized crime, which basically do it for gains, to earn money. It could be a phishing attack in the form of mails or anything. Anyway, from which they can get your information. Another high risk thing is internal developers and the students, because they know your code, they know your vulnerabilities, they know how your site can be compromised. That's why they are also pose very high level of risk. Then there are few amateurs. I just go to the net, okay, there is something called hacking, let's try I can do it or not. So ideally our target should be, we should save our website against these guys, but most of the time we do some silly mistake that we are not even safe against them, and that's a real insult. So we don't have to target them, we have to target these guys. So there's a project, OWSP. Anyone heard about that?
Yes.
So they basically as their name suggests, Open Web Application Security Project. So it's non-for-profit community organization, community. Their main purpose you just to give the guidelines how you can make your web application secure. Now they have extended that, also guidelines for mobile applications. These are getting more popular nowadays. So here we are concentrating on web applications. So they have one very important project, OWSP Top 10. And it's just a awareness document. What are the top 10 security vulnerabilities? And be sure, if you make your site secure against these top 10, you can be sure that your website is next to impossible to break. But these 10 things we should know. Number one is injection, and it is on the top of OWSP top 10 list. On the top is this vulnerability, this is responsible for most of the attacks. And by injection, now probably you have listened to SQL injection, right? But there are more injections. There is a command injection. Whenever we use PHP, you know there is a function exec,
yes,
by which you can run OS commands.
Yes.
If you are passing user input in that function, command injection is possible in your website. Then there is LDAP injection, script or file injections. It generally happens when you use data sent from outside without proper validation. Only way you can make your site secure is then never trust user input. You have to validate it all the time. And that's a golden rule. The only a bit late, but we are on the 9th slide. Not too late. So always filter user input. If data is coming from outside, and by outside it's not only the end user, not only the form. Outside means even database is also outside of your application. Always know where data is coming from, always think, can it compromise your application? If yes, filter your input. Just to give an example, there is a simple SQL query written in two different languages. First one is in Java, C++, or second one, more important for us, in PHP. What it is doing?
It's selecting all the data from user table where the user ID,
it's selecting user ID. Particular record.
Particular record. Is it safe?
No. It's not.
What? So I've sent user ID 10 or 1 equal to 1. My resulting query will be star from user ID where user ID equal to 1 or 1 equal to 1. So it will ideally return all the records.
Yes.
It's just a simple example, but in real application we have complex queries. In complex queries it's become more easier to inject. Because you can terminate your query with semicolon, right? So your database will consider, okay, you have done one query. Now, rest of the part is second query. It might start with comment. Then how can we make our application secured against injection? Same golden rule, never trust user input, or golden rule. Then there's something called defense in depth. Just for example, if I give you 100 rupees, 10 notes of 10 rupees, what will you do? First reaction.
10 notes of?
10 rupees. Some might put it directly in the pocket, some might count once. But same thing happens. If I give you 1 lakh rupees, I will not give it to you. I don't have. But say 100 notes of 1000 rupees, what will you do? Even if I am your best friend, will count it. Right?
Yes.
And probably twice. Because mistake means loss of 1000 rupees. And in IT world, there is a lot on stake. There are not 1000 rupees, there are $1 billion projects. So, defense in that is you have to validate a thing twice. Most of the times, most of the frameworks follow MVC pattern. We have forms, validate on the form. Then we have modeled before sending it to the database or file or wherever, validate it twice. Why validating it twice is needed? Because if you are working on a big project, obviously there will be a team who is working on that. People resign, that means new people come. They could be fresher, they could not understand the thing. They might forget to validate the thing on one place. So it's always better to have defense at least twice. And JavaScript validation is not included here. If you are including JavaScript validation, validate it 3 times. Then, obviously, you should know your data. Nowadays, it's not a vulnerability, but if someone has worked with the earlier version of PHP, PHP 4 or PHP 5.0, there's something called register globals and all these things. So it was just for making your task easier. What it was doing, it was converting all the data into variables. So if, for example, I pass a URL, domain.com/anything, /id=1. Just for example. If register globals are on, what it will do? It will create a variable $id=1. Nowadays, it's disabled by default. But again, if you are working on legacy application, it might be enabled. So remember that You must always know where your data is coming. You must always initialize your data. And again, if you know where your data is coming, it will become very easy for you to take a decision whether I want to validate it or not. These two works on any type of injection, but there are a few things specific for SQL injections, because most of the time injections is generally SQL injection. So prepared statement, as everyone knows about that.
Yes.
It makes things easier, but put it in better words, it makes you secure. So always use, if you are not using any URL, at least use the PDO, the prepared statement. The stored procedure, it might not be applicable at all the places, but if you can delegate some of the things to the database level, it will become easier, but in that case also you need to validate. Then ORM libraries, there are a lot. There's Doctrine, there's Propel, with Laravel there is now. Sorry? And you can. And all frameworks, if they don't know, at least provide some active records library. So use them. They are by default secure. After injection, there is broken authentication and session management. And obviously, nowadays most of the website needs some kind of authentication, right? We don't have static websites nowadays. If it is dynamic website, there should be some authentication, at least for admin or for few users. When you're having the authentication, there are a lot of ways it can be broken. So most of the time, I say, we make it custom, right? And most of the time when we make it custom authentication and session management, either you should be very much aware of all the vulnerabilities and must make your application secure. If you are not sure about that, simple way, don't rediscover the wheel. If you are using any framework, use the authentication libraries provided by them. All frameworks have that. Zend have Zendoc and ZendACL. Then there's a auth package in Laravel, Symfony, in all frameworks. And best if we are using their authentication packages, third party libraries, they are secure. One of the common mistakes, passwords are not hashed in the database. So if your server is compromised or your database is compromised, which can be done easily, I will show you in the demo. There are a few things by which a user might get access to your database. So if it is compromised, first let's hope it is not compromised, but even if it is compromised, user should not get a plain user ID password. The same user ID password he can apply on different websites, and there are fair chances it will work on other website. Simply, we have same user ID password in most of the websites. Then expose session ID. Sometimes we expose session ID in the URL. That is very dangerous, because hackers really do a lot of things to get that session ID. If you are giving it easily in the URL, you lost your security. Again, if I put a password wrong three times, try to log into your Gmail and put password wrong three times, what happens?
It will show the capture.
Right? All the applications that you make, are having that feature?
No.
Why? Have you heard about brute force?
Yes.
What is brute force?
Brute force is trying a particular password by changing the characters some number of times.
If I get the user ID, I'll try the password A. not working, and client B, not working, C, up to Z, or probably 0 to 9. Not working, then I start again AA, AB, AC, up to AZ and A9. Not working, I will start again BAB, BB, CB, D, like that. All two digits complete, I will start with three digits, AAA. You can write a program for that.
Yes.
It's easy. Hardly 10-15 line program. And if your website is really fast, I can try, or if I have a user ID, I can try all the passwords there. That's the brute force. So if you are not having a long password limit, brute force can be applied on the website.
So normally, which hash mechanism you guys use to store the password?
MD5. Is it secure?
No, MD5 is also hacked. Like formula to revert the MD5 is also in the market. There are websites.
It's very fast.
So actually how it works, reversal is not a problem, MD5 is secure.
Yeah.
But not secure, I'll tell you. Why it is not secure. So actually there are some database which records the, which use brute force, get the values, make it MD5, save it in the database, make it where your primary key or unique key. So you will pass the MD5 listening to that, it will return plain text.
Right.
So that's one of the reasons, because the MD5 make it sure it will give you a unique string for any string length. Even for a no character, millionth character, it will give you same length, unique string.
So it's
so
safe. Yeah, it's a safe. As Kapil said, MD5 database are a lot of database there, okay, which can be reverse engineering. You can get the actual password. So better way, you should always have this two way.
Like
we
are using sort.
Yeah, sort.
We are using
three
factor.
Okay.
Like the combination of three things.
Mm-hmm.
One is which
of them? We use sort.
Yeah.
We generally call it sort.
With salt, we are using timestamp.
Still, it is not there.
Yeah. We are using dynamic salt.
Still, it is not
there. It's fast.
The problem with the MD5 is it's very fast. It's too fast that it allows brute force. So, there are scenarios when you want your code to be slower. So nowadays, we use script. That is slower. That is made slower knowingly. And again, one of the trick there, if a user has entered wrong password three times, for the next request, I will write a code. Maybe sleep for 2 seconds. So, it will make brute force. At least it will extend its time. So, one of the bad things about MD5 is very fast. A hacking rate, hacking algorithm for at least password should not be too fast. And nowadays with PHP 5.4, you already have functions like password API, password hash. So better use them. Right now they are using crypt, but as soon as a new encryption algorithm is available, they will start using that. Then allowing leaked passwords. We in the IT industry know we should keep a password unique and difficult to enter. But everyone, your users are not from IT industry. They might be normal users. Even they are users who keep password as password. Right? So Okay, we might laugh, but for them, it's a normal thing. They do not understand that. Because your users are not software developers. Your users are normal persons who might not know computers very well, right? So, if your web application contains something a very crucial information, then you should not allow weak passwords. We can write a program for that very easily. We can have dictionary list of dictionary words, check whether any word password is a dictionary word, or another check, it should contain capital letter, small letter, number, special symbol. But again, we need to keep the balance. As much as you make your application secure, we are losing usability. For normal users, it's a headache. So if you are having a very simple website like a blog, where you need a registration for a reading, and you make 100 of these things like that there. So most of the people will get frustrated, oh, I don't want to read that blog. So you need to keep it balanced. What data your application contains, is it really need that level of security? If yes, do that. If no, leave that. So it depends on application to application. Then no session timeout. And that is one of the most common application from mobile developers. I have a mobile application. If my session gets out, I will get an error. I need to send another authentication request and again send that request. So, but if you increase session time limit, it makes your application insecure. So there should be some limit. It should not be session timeout limit 2 months. That's not secure. Then there's session hijacking, fixation. I'll tell you in details about that. Then there's the remember me functionality. I'll say it's risky functionality. So if you don't need it, if you don't really need it, don't use it. And if the client has a specific requirement, no, I need remember me functionality, either depend on third party authentication library or at least have read all the things about that functionality. Session hijacking, just an example how it works. His attacker, he log into a normal server, gets a session ID. Now he will try to inject his session ID to your victim. It could be done in different ways. He could send a mail, click here, or he could send a script link like that. No, a script is possible in the URL as well. Or he can send a link like that, URL containing some metadata. If victim, ideally, obviously normal user, not aware of web application securities, if he clicks it, he'll go to the server with cookie provided by attacker. He logs in there, but attacker already has that cookie, so he too is authenticated now. Now he can log in as a victim. So that's just a basic example how session hijacking might work. So what is the problem here?
Session ID is common. Like we are not changing the car, we are not closing the session.
Session ID, who is the owner of session ID?
The victim is the owner of the session ID.
No, victim is not owner of session ID. Your server is the owner. Right?
Yeah.
So, your server should never allow your victim to provide your session ID.
Right.
If he is logging again, create a new session ID.
Yeah.
And again, time to time, it's a good practice to keep changing session ID. Then third one, cross site description. That's very common. I don't know that. What it is?
Injecting the script.
How will you do that?
In the text box.
So in general, attacker injects a client side script, but will your server allow that?
So while doing input here, you can put some JavaScript in that.
So probably on my social networking website, it could be my profile. Right? In my profile, I could write some script. So a victim visits your page, and the script will be executed on his server. To get in more visualization, have a write something with a script, visitor goes there, that's the script injection. And if you are having a UI script running on user browser, you can do anything with that. How can we save that? Filter input that we already discussed, that's a golden rule, that saves most of the vulnerabilities. Another thing, escape output. Whatever you are displaying contains voice script, we need a less than sign. Change it to ampersand. So that is basically S. There are more characters as well, just an example. This is escaping. So always escape your output. And if you are using some templating things like I'm not sure about Smarty, but at least for weight and most of the recent templating engines have that facility. They escape all the things by default. If you specifically want not to be escaped, then you have to tell specifically. Insecure direct object reference. And know about that? I don't have a video here. No. So, okay. Thank you. When you expose your internal object.
Name is choose credit card.
Yes.
So that is the like.
That's fine. That one of the common examples.
Okay.
If I need to show a drop down with a credit card user already saved, I have to do that. Okay. This is the problem. What I can do, in most of the recent browser I have developer tools available. I go to the source, I change it say 20. That's basically the ID of credit cards in my credit card table. Do I own that credit card?
No.
So if I change it to 20, I select this card and submit. What ID will go to the server?
20.
So what server should do? Make a payment through credit card ID number 20. Obviously that's not my card. So it should be validated. So whenever you have that direct reference to the object, it's a direct reference. Whenever you have that, you need to validate it again and again, every time. Okay, I get card number 20. Does that user really own that card? If yes, then go ahead. So most of the time we skip these type of validations. Okay, that is, form is created by us. They are getting value from that, it should be validated. No, might not be. So, validation and authorization at all the levels. Next is security misconfiguration that is something which is not directly related to the programming, to your server setup, but at least most of the time developers set up the server. Not all the time, but most of the time. So there are a few things you should always remember. Out-of-date software. And you know what is the difference between any software version 1.2.3 and 1.2.4. What is the difference between these two versions? It's a minor version, generally missing. Which I call both are version 1.2. Insane.
Badges.
Is there any difference?
Yes.
It contains some patches. I'll come to semantic wording later. But it generally contains some fixes. Now you don't know what these fixes are. These could be security fixes as well. So if for any software, if you are having that version installed, and suppose there is some security vulnerability here. Obviously, if it is open source, it will be fixed very soon. They will provide a new version. The problem is you have not upgraded that. And if hacker anyhow come to know that you are having this version, a simple Google search will tell security vulnerabilities in 1.2.3. And it's not the fault of your code. Your code is secure, but your server is not secure. So you can still be hacked. Then unnecessary service enabled. On production servers, because they say we start production server with minimal operating system. Right? For example, CentOS minimal, that don't even have network enabled. The simple reason is that it will have bare minimal things. Install the things that you really need. So if you have extra services enabled, it could be a security concern. Then default account passwords are enabled. And remember Scott Tiger? What it is? A simple default user ID password for Oracle database. Okay. So if you are having Oracle on your server and that account is still open, you are vulnerable. Just an example. So always disable default accounts. Probably on MySQL, we have root users without any password. So generally root users we set it, but again, security settings. There are some security settings that each package, each language suggests. For example, in PHP, you have to turn off magic codes, you have to turn off all things. So there are security recommendations for each package you install. You have to follow them. And this is biggest culprit. Some error occurs. What should happen? User should simply get 502 internal server error page. Nothing else. All logs will go to your log file. But still, we can find lot of websites which will, okay, you are using this data, please query my mistake here. That's our very crucial information. And that might contain this type of information. You are using version 1.2.3. Go. Is there any security vulnerability in this version? Yes. Your server is compromised. Then sensitive data exposure. Again, it's not programming. Sensitive data. What do you understand by sensitive data? I guess most of you have a credit card, or at least bank account. You should get a statement of that. How your card number is displayed? It's something like something like that.
Yes.
What your bank want to hide your card number from you? Mind assumes you know your card number with first four, or even it could be like that. With last four numbers, you can identify which card the statement is speaking about. Gives you 10,000 possibilities. It's very rare single person have two cards with same last four digits. Very rare case. So they don't want to hide information from you, but it's a critical information. If that is state, someone else get it, it's a statement. The postman put it on your home, but you are not at home. Your neighbor take that, or any stranger take that. He should not get that information. So you must understand what sensitive data is, and you should ideally never expose it. Even if it is very important, export it only apart so that original user can identify it, but unauthenticated users might not make any sense of that. Even if it is very important, then always necessary. So there is always a middleman. Then simple, like what sensitive data is: banking information, credit card number, account number, health information, personal information, account passwords. But on internet, there is no direct link between your system and someone. All the information passes this you, this server. So it will not go directly. There will be different nodes over the network. It will go through these nodes. Some of that node might be owned by a hacker. So you should not get any sense of the information you are passing. One trick, use SSL. Second trick, try to minimize the sensitive data. Machine missing function level access control. So probably you have a demo for that, right? I'll show you demo in detail. And one example we already discussed, the credit card drop down list. So it's not for role, but if your site contains a lot of roles, you should have access control list everywhere. If I am a normal user, I log in as a normal user, and I try to change some of the codes in HTML and try to access the admin, then I should not get access. We'll show you a demo of that. That cross-site request policy, it's also common. You haven't heard that. It's ideally just opposite of XSS. So in XSS, if you remember, hacker tried to infect your page. So ideally, hacker is presenting himself as a server to victim. So your browser thinks, or hacker trick browser as a server. In CSR, exactly opposite happens. It tricks server as a valid user. So, for example, again, remember your users, all of your users are not technical. A user logs into his bank website, and nowadays there are tab browser. He opens a new tab, and opens sign of a hacker, and hacker come up with the code. Read it out, user. Check image below. Important. Check the source code SRC attribute of image. So it's sending a request to main problem. Now how browser works, we generally have your session ID stored in cookies. Browser, if making any request, it will send all the cookies created by this site. Now, browser is sending request to bank.com. So it will send all the cookies created by bank.com, which will include session ID. That means valid session. Because, okay, that's a mistake of user. Why he logged in different sites at the same time? But again, user is not technical. How can you save that?
Tokens.
In your form, you generally should have input type equal to hidden and name the CSRF token and some randomly generated very long string. So first of all, that's a get request. But again, I can call a JavaScript function here, and from JavaScript we can send post request. So that's just for an example, but post is also possible. Must have that token, and if that token value did not match, I can easily identify that form was not generated by us. So to prevent CSRF, there should always be a CSRF token on all the forms. And most of the recent frameworks do that for you. You just need to enable that feature, they will do it for you. Subnet with known vulnerabilities. So, we discussed that X, Y, that. Right. Nowadays, most of you use semantic whitening. You want to see about that? There is a website of that, semver.org. So, what's a major version? Major version means you have few new things that is not backward compatible with previous version. Take example of PHP 5 and PHP 7. Your code written for PHP 5 might not work with PHP 7. Because there are few changes which are not backward compatible with earlier version. Minor. Take example of PHP 5.5, 5.6. Or 5.0, 5.1, 5.2. If you have written a code for say 5.0, PHP 5.6 will give you a guarantee that this code will work. So these changes are, you will have new features here, but it will be backward compatible. Now, patch. Say 10. Obviously, it will start with 0. It is completely backward compatible. It will not add any new feature, just security fixes. Security fixes, bug fixes, performance fixes, optimization, anything. But from security point of view, it could contain security fixes. So you should upgrade your version immediately as early as possible. Then it's on the server level, even on the library level. Nowadays we use the, I guess everyone using Composer. Composer.json, you just need to add one line and any library can be downloaded. Right? I discussed in detail in a previous session about Composer. So, first of all, if for any library, say version 1.2.3, if it contains security vulnerability, they are not to use that. But the problem is, how will you identify that? We are using third party library, we cannot identify that. At least in PHP world, I have heard Symfony security database. So it's simply a database which contains library name, its version number for all insecure, and what security problems is there in that version. Now Symfony probably recently donated it to Friends of PHP. So now it's a Friends of PHP project. But more importantly, in Composer, there are one or two libraries, I forget the name, I'll tell it. You can easily find it with the Google search. If you install that library in your Composer, for every Composer install or Composer update, it will go to that database. It will check if your string is matching exact version of each and every library, check it whether it is secure or not. If it is found in that database, it is not secure, it will give you a warning. You can also do it on the web page. You can upload your composer.json file there. It will check all the libraries with its version and report whether these libraries are safe or not. So that is one tool. But at the end, we should never use components with known vulnerabilities. Because your code might be secure, but that library might not be secure. Yes, security.sensorylabs.org. At least here you can upload your composer.json file. Last one, unvalidated redirect and forwards. So sometimes we have URLs like that. In our controller, we check something, okay, we need to redirect it. I need to forward it at somewhere else. So that's fine, can do that, but this is riskier than if you allow this type of request. A normal user can make a request like that. In that case, it should be authenticated by the user logged in, had access to that page or not. So that redirect and forwards are always risky. So generally said, avoid it. If you can't avoid, then at least don't include parameters sent by user. So especially if that admin.php is sent by user, that's risky. Even if it can't be avoided, validate that whether that user is having access for that or not. So these are OWASP top 10 vulnerabilities. You just go through that list. I'd like to know if you have any doubts in any one.
Said about the object reference, that can be done by deep frameworks.